Good morning. I want to welcome everyone to Immanuel Baptist Church. It's good to have you here this morning. We're so glad that you're worshiping with us. And if you are a first-time guest, or maybe you're a returning guest and you've never filled out a Connect card in your bulletin, I'd like to invite you to take one and to fill it out. And there's a couple of ways you can get that back to us. You can put it in the offering plate when it's passed. There's some boxes beside each door on your way out by the exits. You can drop it in there. Or more, what I'd really like to encourage you to do is stop by the table out in the lobby right after the service. And this morning, Pastor Mark is going to be out there. And if you'll just drop by and you can give him the card, he'd just love to be able to greet you so we can connect with you. And again, if you're looking for a church home, I hope you'll give us a shot here at Immanuel. We're, I believe, excited about what God is doing and a great Bible-believing church here. And we've got a place here for everyone. So we're glad that you're here this morning. I do have just a couple of announcements to make. Just to tell you, as you look at through your bulletin, through your worship guide, you'll see so many of the opportunities and Bible studies and things that are happening here, from IBC Sports to just the children's ministry. So many things going on. I want to highlight for those who may be first-time guests, or maybe you've been attending for a while. I know there are many who have been attending, maybe even a year or more, who have not joined the church and you're interested in that. If you've not taken a Connect class, if you would come on the first Sunday of every month from 9:30 to 10:30, I'll be teaching one in room 252 to share a little bit about who we are and what we believe. It gives you an opportunity to also ask any questions you might have about our church. And that's kind of a next step for joining the church. Also, I want to encourage you to remember our Wednesday nights. We have something, again, for all ages on Wednesday night, a great Awana program as well as student ministry. And also, in our adult Bible study starts at 6 p.m. and in the dining hall of the over in the gym, or the Family Life Center. And we're going to be going, we've done finances, we looked at how we manage our money, how we manage our time, and this week I'm going to be looking at the meaning of marriage. And really over the next 5 weeks, I'm going to kind of dig in on that topic of marriage. So if you're interested in that, I hope you'll come out on Wednesday nights for this study. Also, at this time, we will remember all that God is doing here as we go to the Lord in prayer. And I want to ask, if you would, if you'd just join me as we bow before the Lord in prayer this morning. Father God, we come into your presence this morning. God, we thank you for who you are, for what you are doing in the life of this church, and what you are doing among your people, not only here, but all around the world. God, we know that you are supreme. God, that you are sovereign. That, Lord, you are the maker of all things. Lord, that you uphold all things by the word of your power, and that nothing exists without you. So, God, we bow our hearts and our knees before you this morning, recognizing your sovereignty, recognizing your lordship and your glory. God, we praise you for who you are. We ask that you would help us this morning to worship you in spirit and in truth, to honor you with the words of our mouth and with the meditations of our heart. God, I pray that you'd also help us to be unified today. I pray that you'd continue to work to cause our priorities to align with yours. Remove from us anything that would distract us from seeing you and savoring you in worship. God, I pray that you would just draw people to yourself this morning, that you would anoint musicians and everyone who's participating in the service, both up front and behind the scenes. God, may your spirit lead us. May you help me as I preach, that I would decrease, that you would increase, that you would have your message heard this morning. God, I pray that you would also help us to, if there's anyone here today who doesn't know you, that they would be able to understand and believe the gospel. And if there's someone you're calling out for special service this morning, I pray they would recognize that call. God, I pray that you'd be with our nation. I pray that you would bless our nation, that you'd protect us, especially during all the uncertainties that are taking place in the Middle East. And God, we pray for your church, not only here but abroad. God, may you give increase, may you protect. And Lord, help us to look forward every day to your return. We know that you're coming again with the clouds of heaven. And Lord, I pray that we would be ready and that we would live lives of readiness. Lord, we invite you to move among us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, again, good morning. Would you stand with us as we sing victorious? We are victorious as children of God. Amen? Sing with us.
The high exalted King, victorious.
Here's some encouraging words for you today. In Matthew 23, it says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites!" That starts your day off right. "For you are like whitewashed tombs, which indeed appear beautiful outwardly, but inside are full of dead men's bones and all uncleanness." Have you ever met somebody and they seem to have everything together? They dress nicely, they spoke eloquently, they behaved appropriately. But then you got to know them. And as you got to know them, you saw the corruption. You saw the depth of their soul, so to speak. And as you got to know them, you realized that inside there was a lot of shallowness. There was a lot of pain and agony and frustration. Maybe today that's you. Maybe today you're struggling internally, but outwardly people don't know that. We want you to know that God is the God of healing and the God of power and the God of revival in your life. He will come inside and cleanse you from the inside all the way out. And that's what he does for us. Sing with us from the inside out.
Consume me from the end.
that is our prayer today, that you will move among us, that we won't look around to others for you to change, God, but in us, where we are at, no matter what we are dealing with, God, that you will move us closer to you, that you will convict us, that your word will penetrate to our soul. Father, that you will have your way among each of us, right here, right today, right now, God. Cleanse us, Father, from the inside out.
My heart and my soul, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace. To love you from the inside out, everlasting. Your light will shine with all else fate, never ending. Your glory goes beyond all pain, and the cry of my heart is to
just as you are, and he will change you. Worship with us.
Just as I am without one thing, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to. Oh, God.
ushers come, would you pray with me? Father, we come before you today, broken, confused, guilty, uncertain, certainly imperfect. But God, you come today to change us, to mold us, to move us from where we are now to who you want us to become, God. Each one of us today in this place, God, needs to hear from you, from your word, from the message that you have today. So, Father, as we come before you, worshiping in our giving, worshiping in bringing before you a portion of what you've provided for us, God, may we come with hearts of gratefulness and gladness. May we come before you recognizing your forgiveness, your restoration, your holiness. God, thank you that we can come to this place as brothers and sisters in Christ to glorify you and you alone. Use us today. Speak to us. Change us, God, each one of us. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
In his book, Eating Problems for Breakfast, Tim Hansel has the following imaginary letter from a hiring firm addressed to Jesus. Dear sir, thank you for submitting the resumes of the 12 men you have picked for managerial positions in your new organization. All of them have now taken our tests, and we have not only run the results through our computer, but have also arranged personal interviews for each one of them with our psychologist and vocational aptitude consultant. As part of our service, we make some general comments for your guidance. This is as a result of the staff consultation and comes without any additional fee. It is the staff opinion that most of your nominees are lacking in background, educational, and vocational aptitude for the type of enterprise you are undertaking. They do not have the team concept, We would recommend that you continue your search for persons with significant managed experience and proven capacity. Simon Peter is emotionally unstable and given to fits of temper. Andrew has absolutely no qualities of leadership. The two brothers, James and John, place personal interest above company loyalty. Thomas demonstrates a questioning attitude that would tend to undermine morale. We feel that it is our duty to tell you that Matthew has been blacklisted by the Greater Jerusalem Better Business Bureau. James, the son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus have radical leanings, and they both registered high on a manic depressive scale. One of the candidates, however, shows great potential. He is a man of ability and resourcefulness, meets people well, and has a keen business mind, as well as contacts in high places. He is highly motivated, ambitious, and responsible. We recommend Judas Iscariot as your controller. We wish you every success in your new venture. Sincerely, Jordan Management Consultants. This imaginary letter underscores that Jesus does not see people as the world sees people. But it leaves us with a question: what is Jesus looking for in disciples? What are the demands of discipleship? In Mark chapter 1, verses 16 to 20, we're going to look this morning at that particular passage, and we'll find that Mark shows us, as Jesus shows us, that the essentials of being a disciple are following the Lord, fishing for the lost, and forsaking your life. And if you will, look with me in this text as we read what Mark says, beginning in Mark chapter 1 and verse 16. And as he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he, that's Jesus, saw Simon and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. Then Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you become fishers of men." They immediately left their nets and followed him. When he had gone a little farther from there, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who were in the boat mending their nets. And immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired servants and went after him. One day, most likely in the late fall of A.D. 29, Jesus walked along some stretch of the northern shore of the Sea of Galilee. It's a very rocky area. It's a black basalt rock. It's not nice, pretty sandy beaches, but this black basalt rock that's coming up out of the water, and he's walking along this shoreline, and he has a clear purpose in his mind. Jesus is determined to call his first disciples. And as we read about the calling of these first four disciples, they are both sets of brothers, and in both accounts, the calling of Andrew and Peter, as well as the calling of James and John, are set almost parallel. They are so similar. One is almost the same as the other, and I believe that reminds us today that the calling of disciples, whether in the first century or in the 21st century, the elements are still the same. That we have a clear responsibility of following the Lord, of fishing for the lost and forsaking our life. And I want us to, first of all, think of these steps and the order that they appear in both accounts, and that is first, the demand to follow the Lord. And if you'll notice here in verse 17, the very first thing Jesus says is, "Follow me." And what do we find? Verse 18, they left their nets and what? Followed him. Okay, now look down at verse 19. You'll find here, they're in the boat, James and John. Immediately he called them, that is, he's asking them to follow him, and what? They went after him. So in both accounts, Jesus is literally saying, "Come after me. Follow me." He's calling them and asking them to make a decision to come after him in some way, to get behind him and lead wherever he goes. And he is asking them to enter into a relationship, a full apprenticeship. This sort of thing, it was not that uncommon as it may seem to us. There was a precedent for it in Israel. As a matter of fact, Elijah was a man that was well known. He was a prophet in the time before Christ, many hundreds of years before Christ. And he called a disciple, if you will, who would follow him in apprenticeship and who would take his responsibility after he had gone, a man by the name of Elisha. And so we see that there is a kind of precedent for this thing, although it was very unusual because it was typically the disciple who would ask to follow the teacher rather than the teacher who's calling his own disciples. But here it is, very clearly, Jesus is calling these men to follow him. Maybe you're like me, and growing up in church, I always read this story, and it was kind of hard for me to understand. I didn't want to say anything because you don't want to ask too many questions in Sunday school that would make you sound unorthodox, right? But I'm thinking to myself, these guys are out fishing one day, and this man walks up along the shore and says, come after me, and I'll make you fishers of men. They all just leave their nets. They leave their father. They leave the hired servants. I mean, what's wrong with these guys? I mean, if just somebody walked by on the street and asked you to follow them, you probably wouldn't do it. And it doesn't even seem like a good idea. And I think one of the things that we need to remember here is that this is not the first time these men have seen Jesus. It's not the first they've ever heard of Jesus. In Mark's gospel, as I mentioned last week, that there is actually his ministry had begun about a year earlier. And so if we read it chronologically, we understand what John is saying is that both Simon and Andrew and James and John had all met Jesus. They had all heard about Jesus before. I'm going to read to you from John chapter 1, verses 40 and 42, where it says, one of the two who heard John the Baptist speak, that's John speaking about Jesus, and followed Jesus was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. Andrew first found his own brother, Simon Peter, and said to him, we have found the Messiah, and he brought him to Jesus. In other words, they understood, as we should, that you cannot follow someone until you understand who they are and what they are all about. And so as I stand here this morning preaching to Jesus Christ, and you're here and you're hearing that, and you know the gospel of Jesus, or at least if you don't know it, I'm about to tell you that, it's that he came to this world. He is the Messiah, the Son of God. He died on the cross for our sins. He rose again from the dead on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. And he is God and he is Lord. And we have a responsibility to place our lives in his hands. Now you've heard the gospel. You know he is. You've probably been familiar with that all your life. And so in the same way, they identify that Jesus is the Messiah, and knowing that that's who he was, then when he says, follow me, this takes on a new meaning. And so they have a responsibility. Once you know the demands of Jesus Christ, you must follow him. And so we need to respond. And notice here that he doesn't say, well, first of all, you need to go home, and you need to take a bath, you need to get cleaned up, you need to get that fishy smell off your hands, and you need to go get an education, and then you need to come follow me. No, he says, come follow me. They leave everything and they go and follow Jesus. And so the reminder for us is this, that the call is still just as clear. It is come. It is come now. Come as you are and follow after me. It is a radical call to faith. We sometimes talk about, talked about repentance last week. And I want you to know that the demand of repentance and following Christ is all inclusive. It's all in one, because you will not look more like Jesus by standing around getting ready for Jesus. You look more like Jesus when you start following him. The longer that you've walked with Jesus, the more you're going to look like Jesus. The day that you get saved, there's going to be a lot missing between you and the image of Christ. But the more that you walk with him, the more that you've spent time with him, it's going to be obvious to others, just as it was to those in Jerusalem. And these men, although they were unlearned, we could tell they had been with Jesus, Acts tells us. So we understand that it comes through walking with him, and it comes by responding to that call to come and to follow me. I want you to know that you don't have to be some incredible and extraordinary person to follow after him and to make an eternal difference for God. Sometimes we think, well, I'm not worthy. I'm not good enough. I'm not qualified to be a disciple of Christ, to make a difference, to be used for the glory and the purposes of God. But the good news is, when I read this story, I'm reminded that God uses ordinary people to do extraordinary things. I mean, these first disciples, they're just everyday fishermen. And God wants to use everyday people. I like what Abraham Lincoln once said. He said, God must love common people because he made so many of them. God can use you to do incredible things, and he uses many different kinds of people to do these sorts of things. Remember this, it is not about your ability. It is about your availability. It's not about your fame. It is about your faith. It is not about your scholarship. It is about your relationship. When Jesus said to follow me, I think about that game called Follow the Leader. When you have someone in front, they're the leader, and everyone else just lines up behind them and goes wherever they go, walking in step with the leader. And we are called to follow the leader. We are called to follow the Lord, that wherever the Lord leads, he says, come after me, get in line with me, you recognize me as the leader, and you go wherever it is I tell you to go. We have to follow the Lord, and that is the first demand of having a relationship with him. If we hear the call of faith, if you're here today and you've never received Jesus as your Savior and Lord, if right you're here today and you don't know where you're going to spend eternity, we're going to give an invitation here in a little bit. You come and make it clear that you've heard the call and that you're going to follow the Lord in faith. So we must follow the Lord. But there's something else. When we follow the Lord, that means that we're going to fish for the lost. There in verse 17, what does he say will happen when they follow him? Follow me, and I will make you become fishers of men. Here it is, Jesus turning these four fishermen into fishers of men. And when he tells them, I will make you to become, he's telling them, I'm going to take you as you are right now. You are not fishers of men, but I will turn you into something that you are not right now. When God gets his hand in your life, he will cause you to become what you could never be without him. You may have just an ordinary life. You may have a subpar life. But listen, when God is at work in your life, he will allow you to be and become what you could never be if it were not for him and his hand on you. You know, he desires for every one of us to be something. But you'll never be someone unless Jesus makes you someone. And so when he does that, he calls us to be a soul winner. You know, he calls us to be fishers of men. And isn't it amazing here? I mean, I think about recruiting tactics. And if you were trying to get someone on your team, I mean, if he were going to speak to these men, he could have said to them, hey, guys, come after me, and you're going to be incredibly famous. There's going to be statues of you one day all across the world. You're going to adorn every nook and cranny and stained glass window in churches for over 2,000 years. People will still be talking about you. I mean, you're going to be more popular than any president, any political person. You're going to be incredibly famous. He could have said to them, come after me, and you will be the authors of the world's best-selling book. Not for 1 year, but for as far back as we can just about remember. You are going to be, people will be reading your writings for centuries to come. But no, he doesn't tell them that. He says, come after me and I'll make you become fishers of men. Why does he highlight the fact that these men are going to be fishers of men more than he highlights all these other great and incredible things they're going to do? Because the most important thing you can do for Jesus Christ is to be a winner of souls. The most important thing you can do and that I can do is tell other people about Jesus Christ. And John Wesley put it like this. He says, you have only one business on earth, and that is to save souls. The lives and the souls and the eternal destiny of people are at stake, and what are we doing to intervene? He uses that phrase, fishers of men. Now, did Jesus come up with the idea of fishers of men? Actually, he's borrowing it from the Old Testament. In Jeremiah chapter 16, we read in verse 16 there of how there would be these people who would come and they would be fishers of men. But in the Old Testament, it is not a good connotation. As a matter of fact, those who are fishing for men in the Old Testament are people who are bringing people into judgment. It's a negative connotation. It's kind of the same connotation that my grandfather used when I think about fishing with him. My grandfather, he'd always want to go fishing when I was growing up. And one thing I found about him is that he ate everything he caught. And you did not want to be a fish caught by Ralph F. Carter Sr. All right, because every single thing, it didn't matter how big it was or how small it was going in a frying pan. That was just the way it was. And it was never a blessing to be a fish caught by him, or caught by me if I were with him, because I didn't have much choice in the matter. So when we fish for fish, it's not really a blessing for the fish. Yeah, we can catch and release, but whatever. But still, you think about bringing something from death, or from life into death, from the waters of life where they live and teem, into a bucket or to a boat where they are to be killed. And that was kind of the way that it was used in the Old Testament. God's going to take these people and he's going to bring them from their life and bring them into judgment. But here Jesus, he turns it all around. And he says, I want you to be fishers of men. I want you to take people from the waters of judgment and bring them into the ark, which is life, which is Christ. You bring them into me. You help them to know who I am and bring them from death and bring them into life. We are called to go out and to fish for men, bringing men, women, boys, and girls from death into life, into the hope of life eternal. I think about fishing, and fishing can be difficult business. But yet these men, they were brilliant businessmen. I mean, we read that James and John are fishing, and they have hired servants, so they're doing well with fishing. Fish from the Sea of Galilee were popular all across the Roman Empire. So these men have really struck it rich in the fishing industry. They're doing well, and they understood the principles about fishing, and they have learned to apply those to the life of discipleship. That's why he's able to teach them to become fishers of men. And I believe they have these same skills that all of us need, that you need from fishing, to translate those into becoming fishers of men. I mean, they understood that fishing calls for skill, alertness, patient persistence. And these things are very valuable in evangelism. You know, one thing I can just go ahead and say as you think about how you share your faith, it applies to fishing as well. The more you fish, the more fish you catch. I mean, if I fish one day a year and you fish 30 days a year, you're going to catch more fish than I catch. I can go ahead and guarantee it. A few years ago, I went took a group from North Carolina to eastern Texas around Beaumont from Hurricane Harvey. We were doing disaster relief work there. And I was in the room where we were staying. There was a bunch of bunk beds, and there were men from all across the state of North Carolina there working. And I got talking to this older gentleman across the room there, and we were talking about fishing. And some of you have been in my office, and you've seen I've got a largemouth bass that's mounted there on the desk. It's just shy of 9 pounds. And that is the largest fish I have ever caught. Well, I was talking to this guy, and I was telling him about that fish, and he went on, and he started talking about, I was fishing here the other day, and I caught about an 8-pounder, and I was fishing over there, and I caught a 10-pounder, and I started thinking, you liar. I didn't want to say anything. I didn't want to be rude, but I'm sitting there, this guy's just talking about catching 8-10-pound bass just like, every other day, it sounds like at least. And so, then I said, well, you take any pictures? Well, then he gets out his cell phone, he starts showing it. He wasn't lying. And I started saying, where are you fishing? And he started to tell me his story. This guy had been in the Air Force and retired from the Air Force, and he and his wife went through a divorce. He said, when my wife divorced me, he said, I just got a fishing boat, and said, I decided I was going to spend the rest of my life fishing. And he said, now I travel all across the country. He said, I'm entering these fishing tournaments. And so this guy goes to Oklahoma. He goes down to Georgia and Florida. I mean, just everywhere you can imagine, Tennessee, fishing. He says, I fish 200 to 250 days a year. Now I understand why this guy is catching all these kinds of fish, because the more time that you spend fishing, the more fish you're going to catch. Do you see what I'm trying to tell you here? The more you share your faith, the more people you're going to lead to Christ. The more that you do it, the more people you're going to bring into the kingdom. So we have to learn the basics of fishing. I mean, they're mending their nets because they realize that sometimes you can get rusty. It's always good to know the net that you're using. Make sure you understand the gospel and that you can explain it well. Notice also that you have to know where to find fish. Now they have these little things called fish finders. You can ride out across the lake, and I don't use any of that stuff. I just like worms and a cane pole or whatever else it might be. But you can ride out, and you can use that fish finder to find the fish. And I believe one of our problems in evangelism as the church is we don't know where to find fish. Now, I'm not an expert fisherman by any means, but if I go out to a lake and I see there's some trees or something sticking up out of the water, if I see some logs or some lily pads, I usually think, man, it's kind of like a place where you might find some fish. We think that we can do all the evangelism here in the church, and that's not usually the best place to find fish. You find some there, don't get me wrong, but that's not the best place to fish for men. few years back in North Carolina, we had a wild game supper. We were trying to use this as a major evangelism push, and I had these postcards and things, you know, cards to hand out to people about it. And I was driving down the road one day, and there was a little bar there on the side of the road called Joyce's Place. And I'm driving along, and I thought about it, and I said, you know, I'm going to go in here and hand these guys. It was about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, I guess it was happy hour or something. You know, they were having a good time in there. So I wanted in, and I'm saying, and everybody got real quiet when the Southern Baptist preacher walked into the bar. I walked around. I gave some of these guys. They said, "Hey, we're having this wild game luncheon and banquet down here at the church." And you know, they kind of looked at me funny. But you know, somebody said, "Well, hey, what you doing in the bar?" Listen, I'm going to try to look for where it looks like there might be fish. You got to look where there might be lost people. I'm not advising you to go hang out at the bar on Saturday night. I'm just telling you that you have to know where you can find lost people. We've got to identify them. We also have to be patient. One of the things about fishing is that sometimes you catch them, sometimes you don't. Kyle, I'm going to go ahead and tell them. Kyle Ingalls asked me to go fishing the other night on Thursday night. And I'm sitting here thinking, I don't know why y'all like to fish when it's 20 degrees here in Kansas. But anyway, we had a good time. We went out to some place in the middle of nowhere, and we get out there, and we're going to fish for, I call them crappie. Y'all can call them crappie if you'd like. But I got up there, and we had some lights. And before I set up a light, we went and just threw a line out in the river, and all of a sudden I heard something bouncing. We shone the light out there. And there was my line sitting on top of the water. The water was frozen. But Kyle kept saying, he said, I'm sorry I brought you out here and we didn't catch anything. I say, I've been fishing a lot of times and haven't caught anything. Because sometimes you catch them and sometimes you don't. And as you share the gospel, there will be times when people will respond and they're going to receive the gospel. But don't be surprised when sometimes that they don't. So just make sure that we're persistent and that we're faithful to keep on sharing. Because you never know how God is going to use your work in evangelism. I think about Simon Peter, and you see how when he preached at Pentecost, 3,000 people were saved. That's a pretty good fishing story. I imagine he probably shared that a lot during his lifetime with people about the number of people who responded. But then there's his brother Andrew, and I can't find one place in the Bible that really talks about him bringing anyone to Jesus other than one place in John's Gospel where we read that he brought a little boy to Jesus. And he brought that little boy to Jesus who had 5 loaves and 2 little fishes. And he brought that boy to Jesus. And Jesus took that boy's bread and his fish. And he fed 5,000. You understand that sometimes when you use what God has given you and when you reach one person, God is able to do that and do tremendous things with it. Adrian Rogers used to say, we can't all be preachers, but we can all be reachers. And amen to that. There was once a Scottish preacher who had become really discouraged because one of his deacons had the gift of encouragement, and he came up to him and said, preacher, he said, last year only one person got saved under your ministry, and that was that little boy. Well, the next Sunday, that little boy was coming out the door, and he said, pastor, if I were to go to school and I were to study real hard, do you think I could possibly become a pastor? I said, oh, yeah, sure, son. Well, that young boy grew up, and he was Robert Moffat. He went on and he became a pioneering missionary in Africa. One day he was back in England on sabbatical and he was visiting with a group of young medical students. And he told them, he said, there is a vast plain to the north where I have seen in the morning sun the smoke of 1,000 villages where no missionary has ever been. In that group of medical students, there was a young man by the name of David Livingston. And David Livingston answered the call and sparked one of the greatest missionary movements in England's history. You understand that when we are faithful, like that old Scottish pastor who told that one little boy, then that one little boy went on and God used it. God, there is no telling what God can do. And you don't have to turn the world upside down. You just have to tell one person. But that one person you tell, it might all work out to bring to turn the world upside down. Because sharing Jesus Christ and the good news of the gospel is the most important thing that you can ever do. Daniel chapter 12 and verse 3 says this, that those who are wise will shine like the bright expanse of the heavens, and those who lead many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. Let me just go ahead and put it as clearly as I can. If you are not fishing, you're not following. If you're not fishing, you're not following. So we must follow the Lord. And that also entails fishing for the lost. There's something else that it involves. It means forsaking your life. Notice there in verse 18, What happened when these men heard the call? They immediately left their nets and they followed him. I wonder what the other set of brothers did. Look down at verse 20. And immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired servants and went after him. They immediately left their nets. They left their father in the boat. They left their nets. They left their father. They left this lucrative business. We can say that on the one hand, Peter and Andrew represent a quick response. James and John represent a complete response. You know, the brothers, they put down everything, they just go after. And then the fact of all that we think that James and John left behind shows us the costliness of following Jesus. When we decide to follow Jesus, it is a costly endeavor. It is literally the forsaking of our life. We are willing to turn from our former life, especially and namely our sin, that we turn from sin and we turn to the Savior. But also that can mean forsaking old habits. Sometimes it's forsaking old friends. Sometimes it's forsaking old ways. Some of you are here today and you have heard that call, and in a few moments you'll need to come and to say, I'm going to follow Jesus. I'm turning from my sin. I'm turning from self. I'm turning from the things I've done, and I want to follow after Jesus. I know I'm not going to be perfect. I know it's going to be a struggle, but that's a struggle I'm willing to follow him in. There are other times when we follow the Lord and we forsake our life, and that means that we abandon things that aren't inherently sinful. I mean, there was nothing inherently sinful about fishing with their dad, owning this fishing business. But the call on their life was for a special service that they had to leave those things behind. And for some of you, it might involve the forsaking of your hopes and your dreams and your ambitions to do what it is that God is calling you to do. Does God have his call on your life? Is God calling you into vocational ministry? Is he calling you to some particular area of service? It may be as costly as forsaking those things. As we think about what it means to forsake your life, let me say what it does and doesn't mean. It doesn't mean that you have to give up all your friends, all your family, all that you possess and your hobbies and occupation to follow Jesus. As a matter of fact, you know, sometimes we think, does it mean that I have to give up all my money and everything that I own? But I want you to know that it's interesting that they left their nets, they left their father in the boat, that they apparently didn't have a complete break with these things, because we read in John chapter 21 about they're in the boat. After Jesus' resurrection from the dead, they're in a boat. Throughout Jesus' ministry, they used what? A boat. They catch fish during this time. So they still have some connection with these things, but it was a radical new way of life for them. You know, we think about Jesus. He stayed in Peter's home in Capernaum. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 5, we find that Peter, wherever he traveled, even after the Lord had ascended into heaven, that wherever he traveled, his wife went with him. 1 Corinthians 9, 5 says that. And so we're able to continue in our life in some sense. There's not a complete break, but it is a radical new direction for our life. We live it with a new motivation and with a new sense of purpose when Jesus Christ is Lord of our life. That is what it means to forsake our life. And it means that nothing is more important than doing his will. When you put your hand to the plow to do what God is calling you to do, there's no turning back. There's no looking back. It's onward, upward, and Christward, and forward. Luke 9 says it like this: Now it happened as they journeyed on the road that someone said to him, Lord, I will follow you wherever you go. And Jesus said to him, Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. Then he said to another, Follow me. But he said, Lord, let me first go and bury my father. And Jesus said to him, Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and preach the kingdom of God. Another also said, Lord, I will follow you, but let me first go and bid farewell to those who are at my house. But Jesus said to him, No one, having put his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. The call to follow Jesus is clear and it is unconditional. If God is speaking to you, don't make excuses. Don't say, well, I'll do this later. When God is placing demands on your life, it is I surrender to you, Lord, now completely and fully. man once said, and I believe this is true, he said, when Jesus calls you to be his disciple, he puts a blank contract in front of you, and you sign your name at the bottom, and he says, I'll fill in the details later. We must let God call the shots in our life. Mark 8:34 says, when he called the people to himself, with the disciples also, he said to them, whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. God is speaking to some of you this morning about making a first-time commitment of your life to Christ. And you need to come and say, David, I want Jesus to forgive me. I want to follow him. Follow him in baptism, perhaps. Follow him in the service of the church. Some of you say, I know God wants me to be part of this church. He wants me to be serving here. He wants me involved here. And God's calling you to do that. Would you say, I'm not going to keep asking questions. I'm not going to keep delaying. I'm going to do what he wants me to do right now. Maybe there's some of you here today and you felt the call to some kind of vocational or gospel ministry. And you say, I need to make that decision right now. Maybe God's laid some lost person on your heart and you need to come and kneel in this altar and say, I'm going to pray for them. You need to pray and then you need to go fishing. I want you to know this, that God can take your ordinary life and make it extraordinary. Don't give an excuse to God about why he cannot use you. God can use and does use each and every person who comes to him. Would you come as we stand, as we sing, and you respond as he leads during this invitation.
Jesus is tenderly calling me home, calling today, right from the sunshine above with the roam, farther and farther away, calling today, Jesus. It's calling, he's tenderly calling today. Jesus is calling the weary to rest, calling today, bring him thy burden and thou shalt be blessed. He will not turn thee away.
Thank you all for being here today. And again, we're so glad that you're here. And in just a few moments after the service, Mark will, like I said, will be out at the table. I'm going to have to step over into our Hispanic service. I have something to share with them this morning. But you go by if you're a guest and take your Connect card to Mark, and this week we can have an opportunity to meet you. I'm Brother Andy. Thank you.
Well, Well, let's pray and we'll be dismissed this morning. Let's bow. Father, we do thank you for the reminder to fish. And God, as much as I don't understand the analogy because I don't like fishing, I understand that you are calling us to fish. And God, I confess that it's something that's lacking. And we just pray today that you would remind us daily to fish, not for the fish that are in the water, but God, for the souls that are lost. And we pray that today as we go out that would be forefront in our mind, that we would look around, that we would open our eyes to see the world that's hurting and lost and needs your hope. They need to be pulled up out of that water of death and brought into the life that you offer. God, we just pray today that you would dismiss us with your favor and that your blessing would be upon us as we go. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.